Let us open up our Bibles. We are going to meditate on today's message. If we can bring up, please, the first picture that we've got there. Glory to the Lord. This is the study that we are going to have a look at today, brethren. Since we are talking about the fasting and we are going to do it as individuals, this is basically what the topic is going to be about: prayer and fasting. Praise the Lord. So let's open our Bibles to Isaiah chapter 58, and we are going to read from verse 5 to 7. Praise the Lord. That is Isaiah chapter 58, verse 5 to 7. Glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. And we read the scripture in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit of God. Amen. And the scripture says to us, is it not... Sorry, that's from 5 to 7, yes. So it says, is it such a fast that I have chosen? A day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush, and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Wilt thou call this a fast and an acceptable day to the Lord? Is it not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house? When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thine own flesh? So we are looking at this important topic, which is the fasting and prayer. The fasting that the Lord has chosen. Because I'll tell you what, in the world there's a lot of people who fast. And really, what fasting is when you basically don't eat food or don't drink water, or you limit yourself from what your normal portion is, but yet you limit yourself. There are different forms of fasting, and we're going to have a look at all that, because today is a Bible study about this. And the reason why I give it is so that each of us can go away from this place and know what the biblical fasting is, the fasting that pleases the Lord, so that we can not just learn how to do the fasting or how to fast, but that we can do it effectively and that God may be pleased. Praise the Lord. So when we look at some scripture, Joel chapter 2, verse 12 to 13, very important, brethren. The scripture tells us in Joel chapter 2, verse 12 to 13, you see, the Jews often, because this was directed to the Jews, but it's also directed to us, because when we fast, we want God to be pleased. We want to see God's glory. We want, you know, a lot of things that we ask for in fasting. The Jews did that too. But the problem was that in the time that this was written to them, God had had enough of their fasts, because they were doing it in a way that did not please the Lord. In other portions of the Bible, God would say to them, you know, you seek your own pleasure. So in other words, it's like somebody says, all right, I'm going to fast today, but I'm going to chuck on the TV. I'm going to fast today, but I'm going to go to the park. I'm going to fast today, but I'm just going to go and enjoy the beach. No, we're enjoying ourselves. So that's not really a fast that is pleasing the Lord. Because we are seeking to do our own will, to please our own self. And these are the things that God did not like with these people of Israel who were fasting for their own purposes. Or yet, when they finished fasting, they would, it's like a competition. Let's see, how many days did you do? You're not as holy as I am. That's the wrong way as well. But these were the things that were going on. Or when somebody finished fasting and they were acting all humble to the Lord, thank you, Lord. And they can even cry and everything in that as well. But then after they finish their fasting, they go and have arguments with other people. There was no change in them. And this is why in Joel, God says to them, "Therefore also now, saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning." So these things need to be in our fasting. And it says, "And rend your heart." Because you see, the Jews would put on like a type of vesture called sackcloth. And this would indicate to everybody that that person was in mourning, that they were weeping, that they were sad. They would often do that when somebody would die. A family member of theirs would die, they would wear this. They would tear themselves as indicating, "I'm torn inside, I'm broken." But he's now saying to them, "Rend your heart and not your vesture, not your clothes." Because they were only portraying this state of humbleness, sadness from the outside, but it wasn't happening where it had to happen, on the inside, in their heart. The change that God wanted was not happening on the inside. It was only an appearance on the outside. And that's why he says, "Rend your heart and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil." In other words, that also means we've got to put away the sin in our life. We've got to put away the disobedience in our life. There's no point in fasting and we're not willing to put away the sin in our life. We're not willing to put away the disobedience to God in our life. We need to fix those things, because that's part of rendering our heart before the Lord. Because in Proverbs, God says, "My son, give me all your heart." And this is why we cannot hold in reserves and say, "Well, I'll give you 90%, but I'll hold on to 10%. But now here, accept my fast," because it doesn't work that way. Better yet, God is saying to us, "Well, why not fast so that you can give me that extra 10% so you can make it 100%. That's a way of reason for fasting as well. So when we go to the next picture, please. So he told them their heart needs to change. You remember the case that Jesus spoke about when he gave the case of the Pharisee and the publican? The publican who stood afar off, but the Pharisee who supposedly, you know, in his own eyes, you know, he knows the word, he keeps himself from sin, and he comes before God and he justifies himself and he goes, "God, I'm glad that, I tithe of everything that I've got. I give to these people, I give to that, and I'm not like this publican." So there was a problem in his heart, because he's trying to come before the Lord, but he's putting himself above someone. That's not humbleness. There's something wrong with his heart. But yet the other man, who was a publican, knowing he's a sinner, knowing he needs help, comes before the Lord and he goes, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." And Jesus said, "Out of these two, I tell you, the publican went home justified and not the Pharisee. Because he who humbles himself, God will raise him up, and he who lifts himself up by pride and arrogance and all sorts of things that there could be that are in the heart, that is what God is going to bring them down." And so when we look at those examples, brethren, these are examples that our heart needs to be right before the Lord so that we can have effective fasting. When we look at the next image, please. We're going to look now. These are the types of fasting. So if you've ever wondered, "Can I fast?" Because you've got to remember that people are different. Some people are older, some are younger. Some people have sicknesses. I've mentioned to you before, there was a man once that he thought, being in a church for many years, he thought that he could not fast. Because he said, "I'm a type 2 diabetic. I can't fast because my sugar levels drop and you know, all this and all that." And I said, "But did you know, yes, you can still fast. Because it's not just a fast where you stop drinking liquids and stop eating food altogether. You can do one of these different fasts that exist. Because God knows and you know where you're at. And God is not a God that he wants us to start damaging our body in a way where we push ourselves to the point that we become anorexic or something like that, because that's now self-damaging ourselves. We're not looking after the temple of the Holy Spirit in that case. But the Bible does show us that a normal fast would be where you can just limit yourself to just have some water. Doesn't mean you're going to go drinking 2 liters of water, no. It just means you have a normal little cup. That'll be your food, that'll be your drink, to continue on, to do, to how much you can do. There's also a partial fast. It's like the one that Daniel did. The partial fast is something that, you know, you don't eat your normal foods that you normally eat, the normal portions. You know, you take away all the good ones that you want to have, and you limit yourself in your portions. That's a partial fast. Daniel did 21 days of that. Partial fast. So there is a partial fast that we can do. And then there's the absolute fast, or the full fast, which is no water and no food. So all of these ones exist in the Bible. If we go to the next image, please. So if you do a normal fast, you only drink water. And that's, as I said, you're not drinking 2 liters, you're not drinking 1 liter, you probably wouldn't even go 600 mil. But it just depends as well, because you know, some people dehydrate very quickly. They might have a condition. And so therefore, conscious decisions that we make, you know, it's to do the fast that God wants us to do, but at the same time, we're not going to be damaging our bodies whilst doing it. When we look at the next example, the partial fast, where you abstain yourself. Now, I'm not going into these biblical verses because that's why they're there. This study, you could either write it down, or once it comes out, you can have a look at it and go through it in the Bible, so that you can see that these portions are there and that there is different ways of fasting. Yes? You wouldn't expect, you know, somebody who's quickly drying up and needs more liquids to go without water. Or you tell a type 2 diabetic person and you go, no, you do the full fast. Because I've seen that happen as well sometimes, Brendan, that the person tries to do the full fast and all of a sudden their sugar levels drop below 2 and they're like, and they're almost falling unconscious right next to you in the church. But God does not call us to be negligent. This is why these types of fasts exist. And these types of fasts that I mentioned to you, they do it in the everybody does them. You know, when you go to see a doctor or something like that, there's different types of fasts that they ask you to do for different reasons too. But they are biblical. That's what I want to point out. They are biblical, these different types. If we look at the next one, the next one is the full one. And these are the biblical scriptures which show, like you might remember in the case of Esther, when the people were going to be destroyed, she got the whole people to fast for 3 days and 3 nights, no food, no water. The same type of fast was in Jonah, when Jonah went to Nineveh and he told them in 40 days God has said he's going to destroy this city because of the sin. All the people from the city believed God and they fasted for 3 days, for 3 nights, no food, no water. They even put the animals to fast. And when God saw that they had repented and their action of the fast, he did not destroy them. Exodus, we see how Moses was up in the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights, no food, no water. Now, nobody can do no food, no water for 40 days of their own and live. It's not humanly possible. But because this was directed by the Spirit of God, God, who is life, was there directing that fasting so that he could do that 40 days and 40 nights. That's why in the Bible it says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And he was receiving up in the mountain? Every word of God that he was receiving, the first 5 books of the law. That's what he was doing up there. So when God is in it, oh yeah, there's going to be supernatural things that happen even with our body. To the extent that when he came down from the mountain, remember the Bible says that his face shined, that the people were afraid of him. So there are supernatural fastings that happen, that God will move in the spirit a person to do. But that's a personal thing between that person and the Spirit of God, when God has a purpose as to what God wants to do. Let's continue, please. And when we look at this next portion, as we continue in the fastings that we are looking at, let's go to the next part, please. So when we fast, brethren, just as a quick, you know, to understand, all right, if I'm going to fast, there's got to be a purpose. You know, I can't just say I'm going to fast and I don't know what my purpose is. This is why when we do a congregational fast, that's why I mentioned those five purposes, because it gives us a purpose why we're fasting. Because otherwise we're just starving ourselves if we don't have a purpose. You know, when somebody's going to go to the doctor and get an operation, they say don't drink this or don't eat that. There's a purpose why they're not doing that, because they're going to go to get operated and they need that person not to have those, you know, foods in the stomach or things in the stomach. So there's a purpose. In the spiritual, there's also a purpose. What is it that we're seeking from the Lord? So I've listed some up here with some biblical verses. So why do we fast? What is the purpose or the motive to fast? For example, for discipline, self-discipline, that's one. To seek God's will in a matter, to receive a response for something we want to do, or for God, or to make a decision on a direction that we are to take. Because I'll tell you what, when we apply that word in Proverbs where it says, don't lean on your own understanding, trust in the Lord. Now, as we're waiting on the Lord and there are some critical decisions in our life that come, some real difficult decisions, I'll tell you what, it's worth it to get into fasting and prayer. Every single man and woman of God or evangelist, when they want to go and do a big campaign, they get into fasting and prayer, because they're not depending on their strength and where they're going to go. They're depending on God to tell them, God, where do you want to? Because basically what happens is this, they're seeking, Spirit of the Lord, where are you going to be so that I may follow? Because they know that if they follow where the Spirit of the Lord is going to be, it's going to go from victory to victory, from glory to glory. So that's why they get into fasting and prayer, so that God can reveal to them, this is where the Spirit is going to be, this is where I want you to go, this is what I want you to say, and everything that we do step by step in the Lord, He's going to be giving the victory. And we're going to see the glory of God constantly. But that's why fasting and prayer exists. To seek God's will in a matter or a decision that we got to make, things like that. Intercession, for example, King David, he fasted even though it wasn't going to work for him, because God had already told him. Yeah, so this is like fasting for a purpose that God has already said no. So this is something that's a wrong fasting as well. Like if the Bible talks about sin and it says this is sin and we're saying, Lord, let me do this, no, He's not going to let you do that, because He's already said it's sin and we're trying to go against His word. So this is about us understanding how to do effective fasting and what to ask for, to know what we'll receive. And you will know, brethren, that you will only receive what is according to His will. Yeah? When we align our life to His will, then we know that we're going to receive those things, because that's His will. So, fasting as intercession, we can intercede for people. In favor of God's will to for the work to excel, like for example, when we're going to be praying for the souls, when we're fasting for the souls, that's in God's will. Because that's why Jesus Christ came, to give His life for all those souls. And so that's why we're going to be fasting in that direction. So we can pray and fast for that. We can also pray and fast for liberation and protection. Like sometimes there are people that need liberating from certain things. You know, there's certain strongholds in their lives and they need liberation, or they're looking at healing. They're asking for healing. They get into fasting and prayer. But I'll tell you what, it's not just fasting and prayer, God, heal me. It's we're seeking that our life may be aligned in the obedience with God, and the healing will just come naturally. But this is what fasting is for, brethren. To humble oneself before God. We can also fast as a form of worship to the Lord. We humble ourselves to the Lord, and our life, we offer it up to the Lord. That time that we spend with the Lord, we are saying, Lord, I offer this praise and this worship and fast to you. So that's spending time with God. In times of much affliction, like in how the times of in Nehemiah, how they had much affliction, and they sought the Lord so that God can give them the victories, that God can give them wisdom and understanding to make decisions, to give them victory over their enemies, to seek understanding, wisdom, revelation for victory. So there's just some examples, brethren, of a purpose. Yeah. But remember, any purpose that we have when we fast has to be in line with the Word of God. Otherwise, it's almost like when we pray. James, in the book of James, it says, you pray and you ask amiss. That's why you don't receive. Same thing can happen in a fast. Because in the fast, the main thing that should be happening in the fasting is prayer. So we could enter into fasting with a purpose that's completely not the will of God. So don't be surprised if we don't receive. But if it is in the will of God and it's not the time for us to receive, God will, one way or another, confirm to us, hey, it's my will, but it's just not the time yet. That's called comforting. So he comes and he comforts us and he lets us know, continue on. We're doing it in his way, pleasing him, but it's just not the right time. But he comforts us and he lets us know, don't give up, continue. When it's not in his will, you're not going to get any comforting over it, because it's just not in his will. More or less, by his mercy, he may reveal to you through his word or through his spirit to stop doing that because it's not his will. Yeah? So that's many times things that occur like that. Let's continue, please, to the next part. Glory be to the name of the Lord. So now that we've seen that there's different types of fasts, that we've got to have a purpose, that our heart has to be right before the Lord, that we've got to break away all those strongholds in our life and sinful things. We've got to be ready to put all that aside so that God can receive the fast that we do. How long should I fast for? The thing is that the Bible doesn't actually mention to us exactly how long. This is something that in our human spirit, with God's spirit, in our conscience, better yet said, you will know how much is enough. You will know when it is time to stop. And you will know if you've not given enough. Because God is living, and we know through our spirit if we've given enough, if he's pleased with what we've given, or if we could have done better, or if we should have diverted our time in spending more time with him if we started doing other things. In our conscience, God will speak to us. He will let us know these things. But if you want a rule of measure, then let's look at this biblical verse. In Psalms 109, verse 24, as a biblical measure, how long should I do? Well, let's take the example of a prophecy of Jesus. He says, my knees are weak through fasting, and my flesh faileth of fatness. So obviously, when you're not eating, people start to lose weight. And if you've been spending a long time in prayer, then your knees get weak because you've not been nourishing your body, but yet you've been in a position of prayer. Jesus would often spend a lot of time in prayer. The Bible even shows that he would spend the whole night in prayer. So he would do a lot of vigil services of his own as an example to us. So if you want to have a certain measure, there it is. But usually, this comes down to each of us in our conscience before the Lord. And usually God speaks. When we are sincere about what we're doing in the Lord, God speaks all the time, brethren. I can assure you of that. And many people, God speaks to them all the time, brethren. So if it wasn't enough, or if it could have been done better, God will indicate to us what he seeks from us. Yeah? Praise the Lord. So let's continue on. In this next picture, we're going to see, brethren, the results of fasting and prayer. Now, these biblical scriptures show us that there is a spiritual effect when we do fast and when we do pray. The devil steps up a lot more as well, because there's a lot of things that happen. Let's have a look at some of them. For example, we spoke about Queen Esther, when there was a law that was changed to destroy all the Jews. They got into fasting and in prayer. They trusted in the Lord. God gave them the victory over their enemies, and the ones who got killed was their enemies who plotted against them, and God gave the victory. When we look at Paul, when Paul fasted to receive instruction from God, Paul got into fasting, and the Lord gave him instruction for his life. Sometimes we might live in our lives, you know, as Christians, and we say, all right, well, I'm going to church, I'm part of the church, I'm serving and everything, but I feel like there's something missing. You betcha there is. We also have a personal responsibility before God. God will ask things of you personally that he might not ask from the next person, or they might be similar, but these are things that he wants from you personally, from me personally. So when you need direction in your life, people can get into fasting and prayer and says, Lord, I'm willing to humble myself and do what you tell me to do. Reveal to me what is your will for my life. And God will either tell you. Sometimes he might tell you, I want you to be serving in the church doing this or that. And other times he might tell you, I want you out there doing this or that. Or other times he might tell you whatever it is that he tells you. But this is why when we seek the Lord, God will reveal these to us. Now, the part where we talk about how do I know God speaks to me or not, that's for a different study, brethren, because that's also important. Who's talking to me? Is it the devil? Is it God? Or is it my own mind of what I want to do? That's very important too, to be able to discern in the spirit when it is God. But I'll give you a quick indication how to know it's God. When what is revealed to us is in line with the correct interpretation of his word. Because what the devil does as well is he'll grab the word and he'll twist it and he'll give it in a wrong interpretation. So that's why we need to learn doctrine, brethren. That's why God brings us to church. That's why God brings us to learn more of his word, so that we are grounded in the faith and in the teachings of Jesus Christ, so that we know that when these things come and they come twisted, we know that it's twisted and we know that that's not the Lord. Praise the Lord. And the Spirit himself also gives witness to us when it is him that is speaking. So when we also look at Moses, for example, Moses, when he was up in the mountain, he received the law when he was fasting and praying. That was directed by the Lord, by the way, because God wanted to bring his word into this world. The first five books of the law. Daniel, when he went for 21 days, he was praying and he was fasting. And, you know, he had a great revelation where he saw three beings who approached him. You know, one of them was Christ, the very Christ. The other one was the Archangel Michael, and the other one was the Angel Gabriel, who gives him the message, gave him the revelation, interpreted the revelation. All of chapter 11, it's basically Gabriel telling him, and this is going to happen, then that's going to happen, then that's going to happen. All the events that we see leading up, even into these end times, was revealed to Daniel. And in Revelation, it's just confirmed it. So, out of fasting, brethren. And then you've got Nineveh, which we spoke about, that it was going to be destroyed. So there are results that we see, brethren, that when there are things that happen to us as individuals, or things happening to our families, or things that might happen to our nation, fasting and prayer goes a very long way when we are in the Lord and align our life in the will of God. So as we go to the next portion, I want to also mention this, fasting and prayer. Why does the devil also step up? Because of these things, but also because of this next thing that we're going to see. When we look at this portion in Matthew chapter 17, verse 14 to 21, the scripture says to us here, you remember when Jesus came down from the mountain when he was transfigured? He saw that there was a bunch of people there and went up to them, and it says, and when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic and sore vexed.
For oftentimes he falls into the fire and often into the water. And I brought him to your disciples and they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil, and he departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour.
Notice how he rebuked the devil because the boy was possessed. And these things happen in the world today as well.
Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, why could not we cast him out? And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief.
Notice that their heart was not in the right place.
For verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Howbeit, this kind goeth not out by prayer and fasting.
So you see, prayer and fasting is important, because if we don't have prayer and fasting, brethren, then what's going to happen is there will be battles in our life that we come across. But yet, if we are not prepared to overcome those battles, then, we won't be able to overcome them. There is a part that is delegated for you and me to do. God does the impossible, yes. None of us can cast out devils. That's God who does it. But God will do it in a person when that person, their life is aligned to the will of God. The condition of the heart is right before the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So these are reasons why we need to have a life of constant fasting and prayer. Because also, as Christians, we're called to take the gospel to people. And we're going to run into people who, like the Bible says, are lunatics. In other words, they've lost their mind. But it's not necessarily that they've lost their mind, because the Bible went clearly to say that this man, the devil was cast out. He was possessed. And there's a lot of people that are possessed in the world today. If you don't believe me, go look at the mental hospitals. That's gone further than just being an influence of the devil. Because people can be influenced, but they're not actually possessed. But when they're possessed, it's because now they're not in control of their mind. They've gone and done something that people would consider mad or crazy. It's like, why would you do that? Well, obviously they weren't in their right mind. Why not? Because they were possessed. And so that needs to be cast out in the name of Jesus. But yet the disciples couldn't cast it out. But Jesus said, this kind doesn't go out but by prayer and fasting. You know, there was a part also when the disciples came up to Jesus and they say, we fast, the disciples of John fast, why don't your disciples fast? Because when Jesus was around, his disciples would not be fasting. And Jesus said to them these words. He says, can they fast when the groom is with them? Jesus was there with them. So there wasn't any need for them to really fast. But Jesus also said, but the days will come when the groom shall be taken away from them, and then they shall fast. So you see, this speaks to the church, brethren, that fasting is not something whether I like it or not. It's not like a choice whether I want to do it or not. It's something that every Christian needs to know, that fasting is a part of the Christian life. Because without that, there will be battles that we will not be able to overcome. There will be revelations that we will not receive. unless we have that life of prayer and fasting. Now, mind you, so what do we do then when we do the fasting? Well, in fasting, as I mentioned, the majority of what we do is prayer. What else do we do when we fast? So let's just say, for example, you've decided to say, Lord, today from this very hour, I get into fasting. And this is my purpose, Lord. I'm asking for this, this, and this. Okay. So you got your purpose. You've made the start. But at the same time, then now what do I do? So this is where we need to understand that fasting revolves mainly around three, or you could even say four main things. Number one is prayer, having that communication with the Lord. Number two, reading His Word. Number three, praising Him, worshiping the Lord. You know, get into His presence, because that's what this time is for, is to spend it with the Lord. And another point would be also to evangelize. You could go out and evangelize, but with that one, you've got to be a bit careful as well, because sometimes, you know, we run into the case where you might end up going to a brother's home or something like that, or going into someone's home and they offer you something. And then you're like, oh, no, you know, I don't want to tell them that I'm fasting, but, you know, it's that awkward moment. So that's why you've got to watch out for that one, yeah? If you're evangelizing, make sure it's out on the street better, because then you're not committed to actually have to have something. Whereas sometimes if we're in a home and we're fasting and we don't take what they want, sometimes it can be misinterpreted and the person can think, oh, the person can get insulted and go, well, I think this person doesn't like me and that's why, you know, they don't want to take anything that I have. And that can cause frictions, problems. And the fasting that we want to be a blessing can kind of be a division in the end. So this is the wisdom that God gives us to discern what we do, how we do it, the days that we choose. But that it's important, yes, it's important. That we all need to do it, yes, we all do need to do it. When Paul talked about fasting, he said oftentimes. That means, you know, he wasn't just waiting, oh, once a month we're going to fast. No, he would do it as an individual because he also had a massive task. Remember, he had to go lay that foundation and he would go into the synagogues every Saturday, wherever he would go, he'd be preaching the word. So yes, he needed to be constantly in that prayer and fasting. And so, as I mentioned before, you know, there's many men and women of God that God has called them for great tasks. And they have to be of fasting and prayer. They have to spend that time with the Lord. And so that's why that's very important. And I understand sometimes there's emergencies that come up. People who have families, people who perhaps look after other people, people who have to do other things in life. That's life. But keeping that to a minimum, yeah, not being entangled in that, oh, now I'm going to have to wash the car, I've got to go for petrol in the car, and I've got to remember, I've got to, you know, go do a bit of shopping, got to hang up the clothes, and there goes the whole day again, in all the have-to-dos, and the time with the Lord is lost. So, the day of fasting means we dedicate that time to the Lord, yeah? That's what it means, and mainly in those four areas. Unless, if God is indicating to you something in particular, because, you know, God can do whatever He wants. Sometimes it might be a case that God will tell you, take some food to this person. You never even realize their condition, but then when you go there, you realize that God had sent you because that person was sick and they hadn't eaten the whole day. And that's what pleased the Lord, to go and help that person. So it's the direction of the Lord as well, moving in the middle of the fast, that we have to be open for that as well. Praise the Lord. But we also need to be aware as well that there are traps of the devil, diversions of the devil as well. It's like when you want to pray and the phone rings, yeah? It's those sorts of things as well that we need to be aware of, that when we're doing a fasting and God's blessing is going to come, obviously the enemy is going to step it up to try and take away the blessing of the Lord. And we need to be wise that we do not lose the blessing that God wants to give us. Praise the name of Jesus. So as we finish up, brethren, we go to Isaiah chapter 58 once again, in verse 8 to 11. Now, when we learn to do the fasting how God likes it, how it's in the will of the Lord, then this is what's going to happen as a result, brethren. When we look at Isaiah chapter 58, verse 8 to 11, it then says, all right, so let's just say now, once somebody has done the fasting that God wants us to do, now is when the promises will come. And it says, then shall your light break forth as the morning, and your health shall spring forth speedily. Who here is sick? Physical diseases? Spiritual scars from childhood? Things that somebody's done? Strongholds that you yourself want to be free from that but can't? Look at that. And your health shall spring forth speedily. Because, you know, God's going to bring that health spiritually, physically, and mentally. And your righteousness shall go before thee. He says, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. So in other words, you're going to see the glory of God. I'm going to see the glory of God manifest. I'm going to notice it in my life. I'm going to notice it around me. I'm going to see the effects of the fasting. And it says, then shalt thou call. Look at that communion with God, that closeness. It says, when you call, the Lord shall answer. Praise the Lord. There's the answer to those people who say, Lord, it's been so many years. Why have I not received any response or anything like that? When you call, there'll be the answer. And sometimes before you even open your mouth, you just thought about it and bang, there's the answer. That's a closeness with the Lord. But it says, thou shalt cry, and he shall say, here am I, here I am. Beautiful relationship with the Lord. If, look at the condition, if you take away from the midst of thee the yoke, see, the yoke, the putting forth of the finger, in other words, the criticism, speaking bad about people, all them things, that's got to do with the bad heart. So he's giving us the condition. He goes, then shall you call and the Lord shall answer. You'll cry and the Lord shall say, here I am. He'll comfort us in those moments of difficulty, of pain, of suffering. And God will comfort us and say, continue on. You know, it was almost like when Paul went to Jerusalem. The Bible says that if those soldiers didn't come at the time that they did, the people would have torn him apart. They would have killed him there. But then, they had already beaten him. And when he was lying on the ground, Jesus appeared. And Jesus comforted him, strengthened him. And he says, just as you have testified of me in Jerusalem, it is needful for you to testify of me in Rome. Direction. Ah, I need to go to Rome. I'm not going to end here. And his mind was then set, I got to get to Rome. And he was strengthened to do it because the Lord showed up. Hallelujah. And that's why it says, if you take away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger, and speaking vanity. In other words, we can't know, as Christians, we can't just talk pointless things. You know, the Bible says that the word of God, the law of God, needs to be found in the mouth of the priests. You are kings and priests before unto God. People need to find the word of God in our mouth. You know, there's often people that still they're saying little white jokes or Christian jokes or whatever. This shouldn't exist anymore in the Christian world. Or as Christians, it shouldn't exist among us. We should rejoice in that which is truth and shun that which is lie and dishonest. Because this is when God is going to do mighty works. And if you draw out your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity. In other words, the darkness that we're around, it's like we're going to rise above it. Because God will help us rise above it. And thy darkness shall be as the noonday. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Let's look at that last verse, 11. And the Lord shall guide you continually.
Who wants to be guided continually by the Lord? You know, I don't like when I feel a bit of confusion, sort of like, Lord, are you there? Are you not there? No, I like to be sure that the Lord is there. Yeah? How comfortable does that feel? How peaceful does that feel when I know I'm taking a step and it's definitely the Lord who's spoken to me? He's going with me. In fact, he's already there. He's waiting for me to get there.
Hallelujah. So he'll guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought.
And that works both ways, brethren. Sometimes there could be a spiritual drought where people are not feeling the presence of God, but you're rejoicing in the Lord. Because you might be the only one feeling the presence of God, and everybody else doesn't. Because they might be in the spiritual drought, because they might not have fixed the things that God wants them to fix. But as we walk closely with the Lord, we rejoice in Him. And He says, and He'll make fat your bones. You know, there's a lot of people that suffer from arthritis, osteoporosis, all these bone problems. Or perhaps the bones are not producing the blood cells that they should produce. Or if they are producing, they're producing them contaminated already, and they're releasing contaminated blood onto so many diseases that exist, brother.
But God takes care of all this. And you shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters fail not.
How wonderful does that sound? And I love picturing it too. It's like, Lord, it's like I'm a plant, a little plant that the Lord likes, and He goes, I delight in this plant. I'm going to water it every single day. And you know what that is? That's His word. That He comes and He refreshes us and He speaks to us and He directs us and He guides us on what we need to do every day. And as we continue to walk in Him every day, and He continues to water us every day as we grow, God gives us that growth. And as we grow, we start to have more fruits. And there are times that, you know, God, He comes and He picks a fruit and He's like, oh, that's delicious. Behold how good and how delicious it is for the brethren to dwell together in unity. So all these things, brethren, God does for us. And it's a wonderful thing when this is a reality in our lives. It's a beautiful thing, brethren. But you've got to remember, fasting, important as a Christian. So it's one of those things as well. You know, when we first started praying as new Christians, that most of us, we couldn't pray because we didn't know how to. So we had to learn how to do that. And then we, you know, started extending that time in the Lord. And then, you know, all them things, it's the same with the fasting. You might not be able to hit a full 24 hours at the first day, but bit by bit, you're like, tomorrow, Lord, I'm going to do more for You. And what drives you, what should drive me, is love for God, to want to have more encounters with the Lord. It's the same reason why we congregate here. It's the same reason why we've got 5 services going on in the week, because we want to have more encounters with the Lord. We want to grow more in the Lord. We want more of God. And that should drive us to fast and to seek God's presence in the fasting as well. You know, to have those beautiful experiences, whether they be of healing, spiritual breakthroughs, the yokes broken in our life. You know, the mountain looks like it's going to come and it's going to eat us up, and then all of a sudden, Jesus calms the storm. And all of a sudden, He's in the boat and He goes, hey, I'm with you. Praise the Lord. Glory to the name of Jesus. So, beloved brethren, that is the study today about the fasting. So, the only thing to do is to do it. To make a day. And to start practicing the Word of God. And we will go far, brethren. Praise the Lord. You know, I could tell you many experiences, like many of us could here as well, about fasting and prayer. But it's nothing like living it for ourselves and going through it ourselves.